Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Outlaws of Thunder Junction early access event. I'm about to fire my second draft of the format, and I'll be recording for a video here on ChannelFireball.com. We got a banger to start. Final showdown. This is effectively Dune Blast. 7 mana to kill everything except for your own best creature. I will be taking that for sure. Couple nice red options in this pack. Actually, like, it really looks like the few players around me will be taking red cards. Let's see who those few players around me are. So what do I want to do with Final Showdown? Probably like white, blue, or maybe white, black. But what do we have here? The Eager Trailblazer. 4 mana, 4/5 vigilance. Good start. Whenever you cast a creature spell, get a mercenary and choose a color, add 1 mana of that color for each different power among creatures you control. Wow. Well, that's outrageous. Yeah, sounds like white-green. I mean, not because that's the best home for Final Showdown, but just the power level of these two cards that I get to start with is hard to dispute. Also, I can let my neighbors take red and hopefully feel good about white and green. All right. This is another white rare, but I do not think this is a particularly good one. I am going to be more interested in Congregation Griff. Betrayal at the Vault is pretty cool, too. But I think I'll just stake my claim on the white-green combination. Two fast lands. Armadillo, Wingsmith, Hardbristle, Desert. Almost certainly going to be Hardbristle Bandit. Yeah, Hardbristle Bandit, I think my second choice would be the off-color Desert. Full Steam Ahead is interesting. There's probably a world where I'm excited about that, though it's hard to justify a deck that has both an Overrun and a Wrath of God. Badlands Revival, possible Splash, Wanted Griffin, fine filler card. I like the Spinewoods Paladin. Think that's just a great card all around. Can be either defensive if I'm playing towards the Final Showdown or just a big body. All right, more white, green, gold cards. And then I'll start looking for some mounts. Yeah, good point in the chat. I can plot cards to then deploy them post-Wrath. Wow, this is an instant speed Wraths. Isn't that a bit much? So another opportunity to take Full Steam Ahead. Snakeskin Veil, just filler level creature. I think this Boombox card actually looks pretty good. You get a lot of value there. These are all cards that are pretty close in power level, so if it was later in the draft, I'd have a better idea of what I was going for. I'm going to choose to take Snakeskin Veil because I do think I want one of these in my deck when I have a card as good as Selvala. Why is Boombox good? I'm not sure if Boombox is good, but it just... Normally those cards are very clunky, but Boombox actually does give you a lot of value. Like, you're gonna kill always 2 cards, sometimes 3, when you activate it. Okay, Aloe Alchemist, just a way above rate, premium uncommon. So to see that going around late makes me feel pretty good about being in green. Perfect, white-green dual land. Okay, more green stuff. Feeling pretty good about this draft. I mean, this is just classic, like, first 2 picks are mythic rares in the same color, and then just close my eyes and pick cards of those colors. Though, I will say, I haven't seen very many premium mono-white cards, so it could be that, like, one of my neighbors is white-black or white-red or something, and then green is very open, and I'm just getting some white, green, gold cards. Okay, I'll take a desert. Because, I mean, I think there's a lot of decks that are happy to play a half on color desert, especially if you get some of the green cards that count your number of deserts, but then also possibility of splashing if that comes up. Okay, this is not a desert, but I think speculating on the splash is better than taking the Wingsmith, which I consider to be just, a dead average type of card. Maybe if it was pack three and I was feeling nervous about my number of playables, I would take the Wingsmith, but this early on, I'll take the land. Yeah, there's some world where I get to splashing blue for decisive denial. Wow, okay, fun pack. The Avarice is clearly not for me, as that's a triple black card. Villainous Wealth in some kind of multicolor green where you're, searching up deserts, you're ramping. And then there's nothing else that's really that appealing. Like Holy Cow and Bristlepack Sentry are filler level cards. I wonder if I'll really miss them. Maybe I should just take the Villainous Wealth and we'll see. It's so fun too, because if I draft like a five color green where I have access to Final Showdown, I mean Silvala makes an obscene amount of mana. Yeah, the Holy Cow is good. Like that would make my deck if I take it. I'm just not sure how much I'll miss it. And I don't want to miss out on the opportunity to make a fun Villainous Wealth deck, but still, Plan A is just a normal, good old-fashioned white-green card quality deck, but maybe I get to the Villainous Wealth. All right, what's the Sword of Wealth and Power? +2/+2, whenever equipped creature deals combat damage, create a treasure, and then when you cast your next instant or sorcery spell, copy it. It doesn't give protection from colors, but that still seems like a fine card, especially with some trample. Yeah, I'll take that. I mean, Throw from the Saddle is great. That would be certainly my second choice. Okay, I'm taking Sword of Wealth and Power. Prismatic Vesta. Oh, Ornery Tumblewag, obscene. Total bomb card. And I'm getting all the green stuff I could ever want. Okay, Detention Sphere. Possible splash card. Ride Down, possible splash card. Holy Cow, totally fine filler creature. Drover Grizzly, that's a mount. I do have the Miriam. That's, oh, and the Congregation Griff. I think I should probably take the Grizzly. Trample is good with the sword. Yeah, I think there's a lot of ways to justify the Grizzly there. Decimate, destroy target artifact, creature, enchantment, and land. You cannot cast it unless there's both an artifact and an enchantment that you're able to target. What's the Frontier Mentor? Archway. Boy, I'm not sure what to take. Maybe in best of three, where I could sideboard in and out the Decimate, I'd be excited. I guess I'll take the Urtha Joe in case I want to splash it. I do already have one Bristling Backwoods. Vraska joins up. Not a great limited card. I'll just take the free Strider Commando. Okay, another desert to help with possible splash of my red card. Make Your Own Luck is also pretty cool. Patient Naturalist. I mean, this card's great, actually. I think I should take Patient Naturalist. Like, I'd rather just have a great card in my color rather than taking a land that would possibly allow me to splash a great card. Ruthless Lawbringer enters the battlefield. You may sacrifice another creature. When you do, destroy. Whoa. Okay. The ranch, the take up the shield. I think I'm going to take the Lawbringer. I do have Concealed Courtyard. Unscrupulous Contractor. That's definitely the best card in the pack, but I'm probably more likely to want Bristlepack Sentry. Alright. Forlorn Flats to splash my Ruthless Lawbringer. Getaway Glamour. Decent card as well, but I'm going to have a lot of big creatures myself, so I'm not sure how easy that's going to be to use. I'm going to take the Forlorn Flats. Huh, Detention Sphere. Steer Clear is a fine card to put in my main deck, by the way. It's that could be main or could be sideboard. Well, just opening another white bomb rare, the Dusk Animus. So that's an easy one. Raucous Entertainment. Back for More. Those are the interesting ones to possibly wheel. No, come on. This is just cruel because it's day one of the new format and they're giving me a draft where I'm going to play the whole format. I'll do 100 drafts and I'll never have a deck this good. So I'm peaking right now in my second draft with four obscene white bomb rares. And I have the Tumblewag too. So I have five like 10 out of 10 bomb rares. What does this Hostile Investigator even do? That card's really good too, but I mean, obviously just Dust Animus. Pest Infestation? Are you kidding me? This is just silly. This is very, very silly. So my weakest cards right now are Ankle Biter and the Steer Clears. Given the outrageous power level of the deck, I'm inclined to not splash just to reduce the number of things that can go wrong. Whenever you cast a spell, it's one or more colors. You may gain one life for each of that spell's colors once per turn. I think I'm into Path to Exile, Getaway Glamour, or the Stable Master, and probably among those, Path to Exile is going to be the best. I don't think Path to Exile is, like, amazing. I think it's probably, like, on par with the good commons because, you know, if you just Path to Exile their creature on turn four, that's a very real downside. But I will take it and play with it. How many rares do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 rares. With several more in my sideboard. So far I've drafted 11 rares. Oh, Frontier Seeker is nice, but so is the Burrow Fiend. I think I'll take Frontier Seeker. Snakeskin Veil is pretty nice with the double Animus, too, because you just play a game-winning creature when you have all your mana available. Well, in a slightly different world, I might try to splash and play Abzan and play double Lawbringer. But as it stands, I think I'm just going to take more creatures on color. I like the Commando because I just like getting more stats and then also the thing of plotting it and playing it post-Wrath. Wow. Alright, I think the Burrow Fiend is the best of these two drops. Take Up the Shield is another with double Animus, just another way to have all my mana open and make my creature indestructible. Back for more. Now, that's a good card. I mean, I could take it here because I don't think I'll miss anything else from this pack. But it probably should just go straight into my sideboard. Actually, it's Back for More is pretty good with triple Commando. Sure, the Sheriff. I'm sure that makes the cut. Yeah, I'm just not going to mess with any splash. My deck's too good to bring any fail rate into it. Just plain old white green, all creatures, high power level. That's all I need here. So here's 42 cards. Just all creatures, the sword. The Path to Exile, three ways to give my bombs either hexproof or indestructible. Could cut the Trained Aranx. It's good with Miriam and Congregation Griff. So yeah, that's probably those two cards is probably enough reason that I want to just play my mounts. So then that would have me cutting Free Strider Commando, Sheriff. Wonder what's better between the Sheriff and the Commando. I think I like the Commando. And then do I want to play an even split of lands? The final showdown is triple white. On the other hand, I have more green cards, and I want the green cards earlier, and then the Bandit can fix for white mana. Yeah, probably 7-9 is going to be better. All right, so that's my deck. I'll see you for round number one. All right, here we go for match number one with white-green all rares. All right, let's play the Bandit and then just unload my hand as quickly as possible. I'm gonna plot. So playing Frontier Seeker looks pretty nice because it blocks the Gila Courser so effectively. So let's start there. Then the Griff and the Paladin. Yeah, actually, chat makes a good point that it may have been better to plot the Free Strider Commando because just casting the Spinewoods Paladin outright is a little bit stronger, and then also maybe having a 5-5 is better than having a 5-4 Trample. Giddy up. Just straight up trade here, right? Interesting, like how aggressive or defensive do I want to be here? I guess we'll start with this and with this. All right, I guess I have to just path the Ankle Biter. I thought I might either choose to not path this turn or maybe path after my opponent blocks the Trampler, but seeing like I have a 6-6 and a 5-5, just taking away the Death Toucher and forcing my opponent into some unfavorable trades. Ouchie. Huh. Well, check this out. The old-fashioned way. Ah, the decimate without the proper targets. Hey, JF Wong, thanks for stopping by the stream. GG's. Yes, this is, I said I'll play the whole format and never have a deck as good as this one that I got on day one. Anyway, match number two here. I'm on the play. Gotta probably plan to just survive till this final showdown. Yep, I can play that hard bristle bandit. So earlier I had a deck, a green deck with hard bristle bandit, but I had a pretty low curve, like lots of twos and threes, and I wasn't that impressed by the bandit. But so far in these two games with the white green deck, I've actually been able to play it and then just spend 4 and 5 mana on the subsequent turns, and that feels pretty good. All right, Nimble Brigand can't be blocked if you've committed a crime, and it's like a scroll thief. Nice card for sure. Okay. Sky Explorer. Yeah. All right, so all these cards that are going to give my opponent value if I let them survive. I think I probably should just plan to path the gem Lightfoot in their second main phase. Alright, I'll take the three. Marauding Sphinx, flying, vigilance, ward 2. Whenever you commit a crime, surveil 2. Triggers only once per turn. You got it. So using the snakeskin veil to win combat here. Take six. I can still use final showdown to give indestructible. It's definitely possible there against the range of cards my opponent could have that I should have used final showdown for indestructible and kept the snakeskin veil. If you think about like bounce cards, exile cards, mind controls, but it's hard to make that judgment call on the fly without knowing the format too well yet. So I wonder if it's better to crew for the trample or just to attack with the 1-1 or leave mana open in case I need to cast this. But no, there's no way. There's no way that outcome is going to come up. This town ain't big enough. Turn up to two target non-land permanents to their owner's hands. Okay. So yeah, would I prefer to have a snakeskin veil there? Unclear. I guess it would be lethal if I attacked with a 6 trample and a 7 trample and a 4 trample. I would be presenting lethal. Alright, I think I'm just going to replay my creatures. Can lose to my opponent having final showdown, but that doesn't seem to be particularly likely. So still presenting lethal, saddle, attack for 7 trample, you gotta have something. Well, it ain't flashy, but it doesn't need to be in this case. Welcome back to match number three with my white-green draft deck. White-green rares, if you will. Nurturing Pixie. So probably not looking to trade Miriam, just going to play the Patient Naturalist. I milled one of my bomb rares, but not to worry, there's plenty more where that came from, including three in my hand. Oh boy, Oko the Ringleader. Beginning of combat on your turn, Oko the Ringleader becomes a copy of up to one target creature you control till end of turn, except he has hexproof. Draw two cards. If you've committed a crime this turn, discard a card. Otherwise, discard two. Make a 3/3 elk, or for each other non-land permanent you control, create a token copy. Alright, well, I'm gonna have to do something about that. In theory, I could wait for my opponent to ultimate and then try to use the final showdown to clean up.
Just try to stop me.
I can't really get... Oh, I have the Aloe Alchemist. So if I make this a 6/4 trample, or I make this a 5/5 trample... 5/5 trample looks like a good attacker. So I'm going to go plot. So I imagine the medic is going to block the naturalist and the bristle pack is going to trade. I think I'm mostly okay with that. Okay, that works too. Sandstorm Verge can make a creature unable to block. That's also a repeatable way to commit crimes.
All according to plan.
Okay, well, this is definitely happening. Then declare two attackers at Oko. Probably results in just trading Miriam against the Griffin. Oh yeah, that's a great question. What happens if I use the creatures lose abilities mode when the Oko is a copy of a creature? No one knows what would happen. To cast or to plot? Go for a plot. There is a world where, like, if my opponent kills the Dust Animus, maybe I'll try to do Final Showdown and then save the creature, you know, safely in the plot exile zone. But right now, the whole game is about me killing this Oko. If I kill the Oko, I feel like I'm in great shape. If not, you know, this thing takes over a game. I guess I can also just Wrath at instant speed if the Oko copies a flyer or something. Alright, make an elk.
Would you like to see a magic trick?
So pathing the flyer does allow me to kill Oko. I'm going to start by attacking Oko with these two. There could be a world where my opponent chooses to put the Outlaw Medic in front of the Trampling Alchemist. Then I could path the Medic so that there's no dies trigger and trample over. Okay, Oko down.
Off to more successful ventures.
I think I just want to sit super patient here, like with these three cards in hand. It's very difficult to imagine losing a long game unless I rush. Like if I, you know, play the Pest Infestation and then get myself in a position where I have to Wrath away everything. Basically, I want to go like cast the Final Showdown, then cast the Pest Infestation, then cast the Path to Exile, and there's no rush to start that process because I'm already winning on the battlefield. I think I'll just pass here. Remember, this is an instant, so end of turn Dune Blast. That's pretty good. Indestructible can fight through the ankle biter. Alternatively, at 9 mana, I could save 2 of my creatures from the final showdown. Pretty busted. Who wants to see me double pest infestation? The armadillo could become an 8/4. We're not gonna see double pest infestation, but I think I well and truly had that one on lock. Hey, welcome back. I've had turn 2 Hard Bristle Bandit an awful lot into spending 4 mana on something like Plot. Oh, man. The Tumble Wag. Probably just put counters on itself. This is a lot. This is a pretty good draw that I've had. Plotted the Aloe Alchemist to commit a crime. Oh, man, we're seeing the cool plays right off the bat. All right, well, so note that because I have a non-land mana source, the Dusk Animus would not come in at full value. Pest Infestation, Destroy the Gardener is pretty busted. The Sword of Wealth and Power, you know, is kind of giving my opponent some pressure to chump block. Saddling the Tumble Wag looks really good. I think among those options, I'm liking just Pest Infestation, the Gardener, and use it to saddle the Tumble Wag. Make a big attack. Heck, I mean, we're getting pretty close to lethal here. Like, this can be 11. I could deal 15 here if I choose to path something. My opponent has seen enough. That was an unreasonable draw. All right, we're still cruising along with the white-green draft deck. And this hand works too, because the Hard Bristle Bandit can fix for white mana. The familiar start, the bandit into spending four mana. But if the bandit dies, who knows what can happen? Deep Muck Desperado. Whenever you commit a crime, each opponent mills three cards. So it's plot or it's play the Griff. I think we're on plot. All right, the mill deck, I mean, this is one of the scarier archetypes that I could face. And we got a raid from Corticals. Thank you so much for the raid. Good games earlier. You're on the receiving end of a very, very strong deck and a very strong draw from me. All right. So, having only one white mana does complicate this a little bit. I can cast or plot the Dust Animus and cast Sword of Wealth and Power. I guess let's start here. Protection from instants and sorceries can give me, like, a nice, safe, warm feeling against the blue-black player who is continuously passing with their mana open. Woof. Getting Hedron crabbed here. Okay, well, land drop, cast the Dust Animus. Now I would like to try to equip my sword on the bandit. Note that I cannot cast my own instants and sorceries. This is not hexproof, this is good old-fashioned protection. I could double Pest Infestation, but that's not even really better than just casting it for more mana next turn. You targeting me to get the crime? No, not quite. We're not quite at that point yet. So currently 7 mana. I think the move is going to be, do I want a crew for +1? No. All right, and then just for funsies, I'll make 12 pest tokens. Yes, I could have crewed, I could have saddled while the sword was equipped, but that would have meant having one less mana available for the pest infestations. Welcome back, everyone. I'm currently 5-0 with my white-green draft deck. Just a couple more to go to get 7 wins. So for the first time, I've drawn Selvala and can cast it on turn 3. Yeah, I mean, in addition to the card quality in this deck and the number of rares that I have, I've also just had turn 2 unanswered Hard Bristle Bandit an awful lot, and that has felt really, really powerful. I'm just gonna go for it. I mean, maybe there's a counterspell. Oh, hey, look, banded into 4 mana play again. Okay. There's vigilance too. It's just too much. All right. So let's, I guess, attack with the vigilant creature. And then just play 2 things. I guess I could have done Aloe Alchemist the plot first, then attacked with Vigilance, then played 2 things, so missed opportunity there. Still learning the patterns with Selvala. Enchant artifact or creature. Stop cold, enters battlefield, tap enchanted permanent, loses all abilities and doesn't untap. All right, well, That is fine for now, though I do get to destroy it with Pest Infestation. So I've got a 3-3 that's going to get a plus one counter. I have a 3-2. So on the board here, block the biggest one, it's 4 plus 6 is 10, so I think just a simple attack is going to be good enough. Alright, one more to go. Welcome back everybody for possibly the final game with today's white-green draft deck. I'm going for the clean sweep here. If I win, I'll retire at 7-0. So I think the move is, well, I could either play the Burrow Fiend to start growing it, or I could play the Aranx to try to scry into land drops. I think Burrow Fiend is probably better. Yep. That is a juicy target for the Pest Infestation. Before I decide what to do, I want to see my draw step. Okay, so I can only really take one action this turn, you know, assuming I rule out Path to Exile, which would be a bad play. If I play Pest Infestation and attack for a minimum of 6, and then have Path for my opponent's next creature, I don't really know how I lose from that position. Alternatively, I could just plot something, saddle the first striker. Maybe that's better, because saving this for to play on 5 mana. Alright, so saddle the first striker. That one can't really be blocked that easily. Go to 13. Make a 5-5. It's tough. This is not an obvious play. Thankfully, it's a choice between many good options. Oh my god! That's like one of the cards that's good enough to actually make me consider topping it, despite not being a land. Yeah, I have to top that, I think. So how large would this have to be to attack uncontested? Well, the thing is, I don't want to trade against the Sterling Hound. All right, I'm just gonna saddle this. Make it big. Land on top is fine. Okay, well, they're not going to be happy to see this pest infestation. I also have a really high likelihood of being able to win if I choose to path the mercenary. So what I should do is I should play this first and then saddle the Burrow Fiend, and if I mill a creature, then I just win. I did not mill a creature, so... I can't think of any board sweepers that my opponent can play for this mana cost. And might as well. All right, the clean sweep. You know, super training wheel style draft where everything kind of went right for me, including getting just an unreasonable number of bomb rares. But we take those. So I hope you enjoyed watching. I certainly enjoyed making the video for you. We'll have lots of good OTJ content, both on the CFB YouTube channel and over at ChannelFireball.com.